Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Everybody stand. Everybody stand this morning. We're going to sing our song. We sing all the time when I pray.
Chapter 3, verses 16 to 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for another beautiful day, a day that's never been seen before and will never be seen again. Father, we want to thank you for Reverend Snowden and his family this morning, Father. We ask that you bless Reverend White and his family this morning, Father. Father, we ask that you bless Christians all over the world this morning. Father, we're going to ask that you bless the sick and afflicted. We're going to ask that you bless all the shut-ins. We're going to ask that you bless the military. And we're going to ask that you bless all the countries in strife this morning, Father. Father, we're going to ask that you look down upon us as your children, Father, and know that we are as good as you want us to be, and not as good as we're supposed to be. But we ask that you bless us with your grace, your kindness, and your forgiveness, Father. Father, we ask that you look upon our government this morning, Father. Let them know that you are still king, and that there is a kingdom above this kingdom. Father, we want to ask that you bless all the leaders of the world this morning, Father. Let them know that their will should be your, that your will should be their will, Father. These things we ask Son Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Amen. My name is Stan, responsible reading. Responsible reading from our 1 Timothy, chapter 1, verses 12 through 17. It's in your program. It goes as thus. I thank Christ Jesus over Lord, our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Congregation.
He who belongs to us as a shepherd and a persecutor and a God in man, I have shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief.
The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Congregation.
Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst.
But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the word of the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display immensely patience and an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. All
now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, and only God, be honor and glory forever and ever.
Say amen.
Amen.
We got a little song. We need defense. We need protection all around us every day.
Just remember, if you need to add anyone to the prayer list or to the briefing list, or have someone removed, please let me know so I can get that updated. With that being said, please continue to pray for our pastor and family. Please continue to pray for Sister Wiley and family. Please continue to pray for Leo Dodson, Christopher Smith, Eric Smith, Courtney Wormwood. Please continue to pray for Sister Noriko Johnson's mother and her family back home. Please continue to pray for Curtis Mathis, Willie Ewan, the Wilson and Lewis family, Roger Carter, Ada Jones, Olga Ortiz, Alex Rogers, Marie Johnson, Zenda Young. Please pray for Dominique Jacobs Calloway. Please continue to pray once again for our church, the members that you see here, the members that you haven't seen here. Please pray that during this time, God leads us where he wants us to be, where we need to be, so we can continue to grow, we can continue to flourish and overflow with the presence of the Lord and the grace of the Lord. Please continue to pray for our city, our state, our country, and the world. With that being said, I'll get you over to our pastor, Reverend Carlton Snowden Sr.
Now the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. The house of the Lord one more time. Because a lot of us, we have family, friends, or someone that either sick in the hospital, or we also have those that gone. That Lord allowed them to have another day. But we're blessed to get up on our own and be able to come to church.
That's right.
That's a blessing within itself.
Amen.
Also, I'll say for a few minutes that we don't know what we're going in and what, how long we're going to be in this building or anything, because they're talking about trying to lease it out to a chapel. So they said if a chapel come in that we should be able to still use it during our time, but you know, money talks for their boss.
That's right.
So, in the meantime, we need to start looking for a building and go in and praying for a building from 12 to 1. Be praying for a building and God bless us. And so, because we have to, everything that belongs to us in the sanctuary had to go in this storage room after service. Then on Saturday, we got to take it out and bring it set back in. So we don't know what God got in store for us, but we know we got a blessing, and we can count on that.
Yeah.
You know, like I told you, there were going to be some problems and situations we would not even have, so we already know that. So God got it. Regardless of what's going on, God got it. And we just trust and believe in him and just keep at his doorstep, keep at his ear. Lord, you know we need a church. Lord, you know we're trying to grow. Lord, help us through these things. But other than that, everything's going to be all right, you know. And our people are not here today. We don't know why, but we pray for them. And then I also say pray for the Cooper family. They, you know, right now, they're in the midst of knowing of whether they're going to have a car or not. But keep them in prayer that the Lord will bless them, mm-hmm. that they will get a car, because their car been told out. But everything will work out all right for them. And those are others that are going through things and having problems and situations, we need to lift up in prayer. And so we just trying to make it and trying to depend and know the Lord is our blessing and where our hopes and our desires come from. I'll bow here for prayer. Oh, Father God, as we come this morning, for thanksgiving in our hearts, Father. We thank you for allowing us to be here. We thank you for watching over while we slept and slumbered last night, Father. Father, we thank you for those that are with aches and pains and turmoils and problems and situation that if they're given to you, that you can make a difference in them. If they really trust and believe in you, that you will make a difference, Father. We thank you for our shortcomings. We thank you for our ups and our downs, Father. We thank you for our families, our friends, our jobs, our churches, the other people that are in the body of Christ, all churches, all denominations, Father. We thank you for this, Father. We thank you just for another day, Father. We see the turmoil, not just in this town, not maybe in our household, maybe in the cities and in this country and around the world, Father. We hand them to you, Father. You have the answer to them, Father. We ask you to bless and direct and guide us in ways that could be your way, Father. We thank you for just being there when we need you and being there when we don't need you. You're there 24/7. You're not like us, Father, that you take time out to do a different thing, but you study on the job 24/7, Father. Regardless of what's going on, you're not too busy that we can't call on you, Father. You're not too busy that you won't take time out for us, Father. And we thank you for that, Father. We thank you for being able to show us what you care and how much you love us, Father. Sometimes we get too busy for you, or sometimes we do things that we should be with you or other things, but Father, you just forgive us anyway, Father. You are loving God and understanding God. We thank you for this, Father. We ask you to keep us in your hands and your arms. Bless our families and bless us, Father. Bless us in the way that you can and you will. Bless all churches. Bless all of your children, Father. We ask you these things and all things. In your Son, name Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Father God, we come to lift up this offering to you. We ask you to bless the givers. Bless those that don't have, but bless them for being here. But touch hearts and minds, Father. Let us be able to be about your business and take this money and use it for the lifting of your kingdom, Father. And you can use it and bless it more than abundantly, more than we can need and more than we have. That you can make it where we can help and reach out and do things that you would have us to do. We ask you these things and all things. In Son, name Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
In the hands of the choir and the usher. Thank you.
the song is called He's All Over Me.
Okay, thank you.
church say amen.
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 Amen. Here I am.
Here I am.
I'm yours. Sign, seal, and delivered.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
I've been signed to you. I've been delivered to you. I'm all yours to do what you want to do with me.
Amen.
And let me do what you want me to do, not what I want to do. Because that would cause my problem is me and not you. And when we learn that we listen and be obedient to him, everything gonna be all right when the morning comes.
Amen.
Great.
Sometimes we get beyond ourselves and want to do what we want to do. We want to party and have a good time. But after the party and you're drunk and you're headache and you're sick, then you're calling on him. You didn't call on him to drink that alcohol and smoke them weed, did you? You didn't call on him to dance all night, and then the next morning holler about I'm hurting and my feet are bad. You didn't call on him when you wake up and you put in your hand and you can smell the alcohol and the bad breath. When you was having a good time, you thought. But when the good time is over, when the reality set in,
yeah.
You're ready to call and say, Jesus, help me now. You weren't thinking about him when you were strutting your stuff. You weren't thinking about him when you were, cheers. I have another one. It's on me. But when the damage is done, put it on. It's on you. Sign, seal, and deliver, don't we say? But do we really take the time and go about his business? We come to church for an hour or whatever time to say thank you, and then after that, you leave out that door, you're back to your own thing. I want to do it my way. I don't have time now. I took off my hour for you. I did everything I need to do in that hour. So the next 23, the next 7 days, not 23 hours, the next 7 days, I'ma do it like I wanna until something happens. When something happens, you're calling them, see like their phone is ringing. That's what you're trying to say. Oh God, don't be busy on me. I need you now. Help me, Lord. Where's your help when I... See, it's sometimes when things happen, we ask the Lord, where you at when I need you? See, that ain't until you get in trouble. When things are going all right, and when you're doing what you want to do, and you don't care who you're hurting or who you're talking about, it's all good. But when the cookie crumble and the problem turn on you, who do we call on? Who do we call on? I ain't got time for you, God. I gotta go get a haircut. I gotta go get my hat fixed. I ain't got time for you, God. I gotta go take care of this. I gotta go take care of that. But like the song says, who's all over you? Who's all over you? Who's giving you the mindset, the will to be able to do what you're doing, and you're not taking time for him? We need to stop and think about what we're doing. We need to stop and thank him. We need to stop and praise him. We need to stop and tell him, God, let me do it your way. I don't care how old he is or how young he is. You're going to come to him. You're going to come to him after the mistakes are done or after you can't figure out things.
But do you go to him before you figure things out? Do you go to him and try to say, God, what is it I need to do? Where I need to be? How I need to do it? Lord is able. He looks over you. He looks over you. I know some folks say, if I was God, but if you were God, what a messed up world it would be.
Great.
If you stand for the reading of the word is coming out of 1 Timothy. First chapter 1, verse 12 through 17, is in the program. And while you're doing that, I'm praying. Oh, Father God, as we come today, Father, we're asking you for guidance and direction, Father. We're asking you a word from heaven, Father, for no other God we know, Father. We ask you to forgive us our sins and our shortcomings. Let us be able to see you. Let us be able to know how you are not too busy for us, but it's us too busy for you, Father. We ask you to give us a message today. Let us be able to understand and get closer to you and do what and be what and work in a way that is pleasing to you, Father. Regardless of what you give us, we need to be able to thank you all the time, Father. We need to be able to praise you, Father. And as you allow us to stand this morning, as you allow us to hear and see and breathe today, thank you, Father. And we ask you for continued blessing. Help us to see you in the message today. Help me to have something in there for me too, Father. We just ask you and thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, what he's done. And we need to believe and trust in him regardless of what we think or what we don't think, Father. We ask you these things and all things. In your son's name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The scriptures, as I say, 1 Timothy, 1st chapter, verses 12 to 17 goes as thus. I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointed me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I act in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here's a trustworthy saying that deserves fully accepted. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners of whom I was worse. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immediate patience and example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honored and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
If I would, I'd like to use the subject, I once was lost, but now I've been found. Turn to your neighbor and say,
I once.
Pastor Thomas and the Chosen Devil had to sing a song called Jesus is Enough. The song said, Hallelujah, Jesus picked me up, turned me around, and put me on high ground. Jesus formed me. Have you been found me? Have you been lost? Have you been found? Are you still lost? I once was lost, but now I've been found. And the song is saying, he turned me around. Have you been found? Or are you still lost? Have you got between the turnarounds and in the middle and you don't know what way to go? Yeah, you're straggling the line. Are you thinking you're doing, today you're doing all right, but tomorrow you're back where you was? Have you been found? Or are you still lost? You know, down there in the dam, or Boulder City, what we call it, a Boulder Dam, you know, if you, there's a point there, divide. If you stand on that line, at 9 o'clock, you can be in Nevada, and at 10 o'clock, you can be in Arizona. But here you are, you're straggling. Which one are you in? Are you in Nevada, or are you in Arizona? Sometimes in life, with our problems, do we have problems, or do we make problems? Sometimes we think people don't like us, but when people are really liking you, but you don't like yourself. Mm-hmm. I say sometimes if the man in the mirror can cause you more problems than anybody.
Yes, Lord.
Because what you believe and what you don't believe, what you understand and what you don't understand, what you can see and what you can't see. I once was lost. But now I'm found. In the scripture today, we find Paul proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ for what it had done to him, for what it had made a change to him. And in that 12th verse, Paul is talking about through God's grace. He's talking about what God had done for him. He's talking about how God has blessed him and how God has put him in his ministry, gospel ministry. He's uplifting God. He's thanking God. But, you know, throughout this 12, these verses here, one thing about it, you know, folks give a testimony and say, I'm this and I'm that. Bragging about themselves. Paul wasn't bragging about himself. Paul was telling you what Jesus had done, how the turnaround, how he used to be lost, but now he found. And then when you go down to the 13th verse, Paul talks about the old sinner. He talks about being a blasphemer. He didn't have nothing to do with Jesus. He didn't have nothing to do with God. He would laugh and go fight the people that go in the church and try to kill them and keep them from going to church. Paul had a hatred. He was a violent man. He had a hatred against those that were lacking Christ, against those that had something to do with God. Has something to do, but it said he was ignorant and stupid because he didn't realize the God he thought he was serving wasn't the God that really everybody as a Christian was serving. He was ignorant to that he thought he could make up his rules as he goes along. That he could talk about them Christian folks. See, sometimes people talk about you as Christian. Sometimes we see them violent. And I tell you what, go to the store and don't give somebody something and they know you're a Christian. Oh, you ain't no Christian. What kind of Christian are you are? You know?
Preaching.
But people are ignorant to that they don't know the Lord. They're enemies of the Lord. They're ignorant to what God can do. And what God will do.
Amen.
See, we can talk about them now, but when you was lost, when you was out there partying, when you was out there cursing and pointing and calling people all kind of names and shooting and doing things, you was ignorant to what God had for you. You didn't have no belief that God could make a difference and make a change in you. He had violence. Oh, man, you can give me that money. I can go buy me a bag of cigarettes. You give it to that old preacher. But that's when you was lost.
Yeah.
That's when you hadn't been found. But on that road to Damascus, there came a change in Paul. As Jesus came down and put the scales over his eyes and made him fall to the lid, and he told him, why persecute me? See, that's when you were ignorant and didn't know the Lord.
Preach.
You were persecuting.
Yes.
You were laughing at it. You were helping people talk about those that go to church. I ain't talking about this, y'all. I remember my days when I was young and used to laugh at people and like folks say, ah, you going to church, what you going to do in church? Do the holy dance or do something? Mm-hmm. See, all of us at one time before we knew the Lord, mm-hmm. all of us was blaspheming.
That's right.
Ain't nobody in here can't say that they never prosecute, had something to say about somebody going to church because they wasn't going. And try to beat him out of the money and put it in the church and have things to say about him putting the money in the church. Because if when you realize that if the church is going right and heading the right direction, there's no better place that you can invest in.
Amen. Amen.
In the church. Because God said, if you bring your tithes to the storehouse, to the church, I'll pour you out of many blessings that you can't handle from the windows of heaven. But, you know, we have to work out that for our own self. See, like we work out other things for our own self till we have problems, till we start, oh God, I'm going to do this. I don't know why we flea bargain with God. If you do this, I do that. When we're down on our knees and problems and situations, we're telling God what we're going to do if you do this. Instead of just saying, God, help me. When you bring me out of this situation, help me see you. Help me do what you want me to do. Give me the strength. Give me the desire. See, that's what Paul was talking about in that first verse. The change that God made. Then he went down to the 13th verse, and Paul said, thank you about saving me. On the 14th, thank you for saving me through God's grace, his faith, his mercy, and the love in me, I can see. I can understand. I can do. When he saved you, little by little, your eyes start opening up. See, your eyes not fully open because there's still more to learn. He give you a little here, a little there. A little down will do you so you won't be greedy and think you know too much. You know, you see people that been in church, ah, I know this and I know that, and you can't tell me nothing. But every time they go to church and a preacher talk or they be in Sunday school, they learn more. So it's not a limit to what you can learn and know about God. It's not a limit to what he showed you. It is not a limit to what he'll do.
Preach.
Then Paul goes into the 15th verse that said, Jesus came to save a sinner like him, which was chief sinner. He had told you in that 13th verse how he killed, how he blasphemed, how he was violent, and what he did against the Christian. He told you he was the chief sinner. Now, he t- telling you, regardless of what you think you done done or did or gonna do, God can save you if you let him. God can change you if you let him. But once I was lost, but now I'm saved. All of that yesterday stuff don't have to be tomorrow's stuff. If you look for the hill, look for Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ can set it right. I once was lost, but I've been found. I once was ignorant because I disbelieved. As a believer, I found out who God really is. I found out if I walk towards him, if I talk to him, if I spend time with him, if I take time out for him, then he'll be there for me.
Amen.
If I quit saying, well, I gotta do this, I gotta do that. But Paul was saying that Jesus blessed him, a son. Jesus enabled him to become a missionary, a preacher, through his grace, through his mercy. Jesus gave him, as part of the body, a job to do. Jesus gave everyone and anybody in here a job to do in the body. He gave you talent to do some things. And if you want to be happy, if you want to stay on top, if you want to have some things, if you want to do some things, what Jesus gave you and asked you to do in the church, in your family, to represent him. See, this morning, one of the pastors talked about his son coming to church. And his son told him, but Dad, I let the church down. He said, no, son, you didn't leave the church. You didn't let the church down, but you let God down. Mm-hmm. A lot of times, we think we let the church down, but we let God down. Like I tell people sometimes, oh, Pastor, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, or this or that. You're not lying to me, but you're lying to who I'm speaking for, and that's God, Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. When you say you're going to do something, and you know you ain't going to do it, you ain't lying to me. You're lying to Jesus Christ. Because if you once were lost, and now you're found, you know who my boss is, you know who I'm speaking for, and he's using me to represent him.
Preach.
See, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. But when that time comes, there's an excuse for doing that. I this morning, I was doing something, and a thought came to my head. It said, what would you do if God took a day off? If God told you, I don't want to be bothered, I'm too tired, I got some other things to do, fend for yourself this day. What do you think the world would be like that day? How do you think we get along if God took a day off? If we didn't have nobody to cry to or come to or talk to, what you think? If God took a day off. But we can take days off from him and think nothing of it. The talent he give us, the things he have for us to do. Oh, I got something else to do. What if God took a day off? Really think about it. What would God do to take a day off? The closest thing we can get to, he might have took a day off, was when Jesus died on the cross. When he let cover the world with the darkness. But he did that because he couldn't look at sin. He did that for his son to finish what he came down here for. His son came down, his son didn't come, he didn't just come to teach us, to love us, but he came to save us. as we sinners, to bring us back to his Father. My, if Jesus had said, I'm too tired, I don't want to go to the cross today. Mm-hmm. I've been partying too long, I'm too drunk to go to the cross. Mm-hmm. I got to go to tap dancing school. Oh, they got a party over here, a party over there. I can't make it to the cross today. What would it be? What would it be? Then we wonder why we have problems and situations. What are we doing for Jesus? But we're not lost no more. But we are found by Jesus Christ. He has the answer. If we invest in him, if we start taking time and get more involved in it, if we start doing the things that he has us to do. And figuring out, well, I got to do this for God. We put him backwards and we step forward. Mm-hmm. Then we wonder why sometimes we're not getting anything, because God knows there's something, if he give it to us, we're going to push him in the back. Because we got to tend to that. We got to worry about that. We ain't got time. I once was lost. But now I've been found. Paul tells us Jesus is the Lord, the eternal King. He teaches Jesus God. Jesus is God manifested in the flesh, the only wise God. Jesus knows us better than we know ourselves. But sometimes we like the hobos hopping on the train. One day we're on that train, we're feeling good because we're catching a ride. But when we get to a point where I can't go there, I can't do this, that's too hard for me, we hop off the train. That's how we do Jesus. We hop on and off the train. Mm-hmm. What benefits us, what's good for us, that's what we're going to do. But do we really reach down deep and try to figure out what would God do, or how he want us to act, or how he want us to be? But we're going to be what we want to be. You can't tell me nothing. That's what we're telling you. You can't tell me nothing. I do what I want to do. But when things happen, when things bring you down, when the tears and you can't hardly breathe and you get to shaking, you get to nervous, and you don't know if you're going to die or you're going to get kicked out your house or something's going to happen, what do you do? You call on him.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And the strangest thing happened. He don't tell you, I'm busy. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be bothered. Mm-hmm. I'm sick. I'm hurting. I got something else to do. He said, okay.
Amen.
I got you.
Amen.
Amen. Regardless of what you do, he never hollered at you. He never turned you down. He never screamed. He come to you, and you can hear something, and you can feel something coming in your body. You can hear something coming in your body. You can feel the joy that he brings.
Feel the joy. Feel the joy.
Do we give him that same joy? Do we give him that same opportunity to say, thank you, I appreciate what you did for me. Thank you. Because sometimes the thing we do, other people are looking at how what we going to do to see what they want to do. Mm-hmm. It's not the people on the outside keeping from coming to church, but the people on the inside. When the people in the inside of the church act like the people in the world, what difference I have? They ain't got no more than me. So what difference? They ain't got no peace. They ain't got no happiness. They ain't got no joy. So why should I go to church? I
Get drunk and just be jealous. Happened that when they up there tap dancing and talking about the Lord and everything. But we are the people. We are God's servant. We are the one God have gave different jobs and different things to do. We are his disciples. Everyone in here has a ministry. Everyone in here has a job. Everyone in here, God has given you something that you can bring to the church to help bring people in the church, to help show people how good God is. It's just like I go back and say, when Trump came to office, everybody, how are we going to do now? And this and that. And all I used to say, trust in the Lord. You might go through some things. Things might happen. But trust in the Lord. He'll make a change. The more you trust in the Lord, the more you don't have to worry about that light bill, that car note, that house note. The more you trust in the Lord and do his way, things will change.
Amen. Amen.
A lot of things that break a lot of people down, things will change. And you look at Big Mama or Big Uncle, they used to pray all the time and happy all the time. And when you go to them, they were talking, and you could never see them talk about nothing wrong, but they was always talking about what God would do. Mm-hmm. I once was lost. But now I've been found.
Been found.
Have you been found?
Been found.
Hey. Have you been lost?
Been lost.
Are you still lost? Are you sitting at Boulder Dam on Arizona in Nevada, not knowing which way to go? God is the answer. God is the truth.
Always.
God is the way.
Always.
Jesus talked with you. He not only talked with you, he talked for you. When you pray to him and the Holy Spirit, he goes and talks to God. Mm-hmm. And tells God, hey, there's a problem down there with him. He's going to talk for you. Mm-hmm. He's going to talk with you. He's going to give you relief. He's going to give you answers. He's going to give you direction. Like you say, pop, pop, fear, fear, over the leaf of the other. When you call on that name, Jesus, 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 Jesus. It's something about it. It make a change. It make your mind, your body, and everything feel better. Maybe that's why when Jericho fell, they told him to march around 7 times. Do some certain things sometimes. Soldier brought it, the general brought his daughter out. I'm came to get the lepers out of, and the prophet told him to go dip in them. And thank God. Sometimes people tell you the right thing, but you better watch out now. Don't listen on any and everybody now.
Right, right.
There's some folks who tell you something to make you look like a fool. Mm-hmm. But you better realize this is a God-fearing person. This is God, something that I feel that God can direct me to. You better know. And you better be about your business. But Jesus is with you. The song said, he's all around you. He's for you. Jesus, like a chili, he running on the side. He running in front of you. He running in the back of you. He's there for you. If you let it. If you believe in it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Then we go into a close.
Thank you, Jesus.
Call on Jesus. Let him find you if you're lost. If you don't know what to do. If you're strapped in line, call on Jesus. He'll find you. He'll find you. I'm going to say something that happened to me when I was about, I think I was about 11 years old. 1962, we were down in Seattle, Washington. We was at the World's Fair. We went to World's Fair. My mama, my brother, and me and another person went. And so
we walking around and I guess me being snotty nosed and crazy. I wasn't paying attention, they walked off and left me. Or either I went the wrong way, made the wrong turn. For a whole day, I was lost. Ain't had no money to buy nothing. We didn't have no cell phone then. I'm up in Seattle, Washington, 11 years old. I didn't even know the place to go to where we were staying if somebody was trying to help me. And I just kept walking around. The only thing that was alive was every once in a while I find an exhibit that has something free to eat. I eat that. And I'm crying and kind of, then I stopped crying and got to walking. And sometime that evening, I happened to be walking. And what you said, Mama! That was my mama. My brother. The lady we were staying with. The guy was with us. I was one happy joke. And the first thing they did, they took, that's the first time I had the big strawberry cake waffle. They buy me one of them. I tore that thing up. But I said that to say that when you're found by the right individual, when you're found by Jesus Christ, everything can be a strawberry to you. I once was lost, and now I'm found. The doors of the church are open.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Would you come, candidate for baptism, Christian experience, our level? The doors of the church are open. I once was lost, now I'm found. He's all over me, the song says. He's all around me. He's everywhere. Let him be your direction. Let him be your filter. Let him do the thing that he needs to do. I once was lost, but now I'm found.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Yes, Lord. Amen.
The doors of the church are open. The doors of the church are open. Give him a chance to find you. Give him a chance to know you. Let him give you that strawberry waffle. He definitely. He can forgive you when nobody else can forgive you. He can help you, strengthen you, and heal you when nobody else can. When you at your last and you're lost and you have nowhere to turn, he's there. He's there waiting on you. Bring all your burdens, all your troubles, all your pain and your aches. He's there for you. Try for yourself. If you haven't tried, try for yourself. If you've been in the hospital, if you've been bad news from the doctor, and you have bad news from your family, and you call on him. He's just like the mailman. He'll deliver. Rain, snow, heat, or sleep, he'll deliver.
I tell you what a good God, what a great God, what he has created and done for us, the doors of the church open. All right, then we're going to close it down and have everybody stand. Due to circumstances, we don't know what's going on. We have to take everything out of here and put it in the storage room and then bring it back on Thursday. If you like to want to stay and help us load some stuff up, we're going to load it in the truck and take it away from the storage and also put this back in the storage and stuff back in church. We say thank you. But if you go, you just go. But are you lost or have you been found? God is it. Well, Father God, as we come, we give thanks to you for what has been said and done, Father. Well, I pray that things been said that help people to realize that you're there for them. You're never too busy. You never turn them away. You're their answer. And you're there to give them joy, peace, and happiness, Father. I pray that we learn to serve you better. We learn to realize what you're doing for us, Father. That through aches and pains, that what we got down here is nothing compared to what we have up in heaven, Father. You're just preparing us and seeing if we're going to believe and trust in you. Are we going to serve you and do the things that need to be to uplift the kingdom, Father? Help us come stronger. Help us come in the right direction and be what and do what you would have us do. We ask you these things. And prepare us when we leave here that we can see more, think more, and be more disciplined in your ways, Father. Let us be able to tell people about you. Let us be able to be your disciples, full of with the right words to say and how to talk, and don't put nobody down, but be able to tell them, regardless what you think you can't do or what you think you'd have done. Paul said he was the chief sinner, but look what he done for him. Let him know there's nothing under the sun or under the moon that we can do that you can't forgive us for, Father. And we thank you for this. And we thank you for making us better people, Father. Making us strive to see you in what we do. We just ask you to bless us as we leave here. Bless our family. Bless our job. Bless the people we come in contact with, Father. Give us the heart to talk more about it. Give us the heart to bring people in to you and lead them to Christ, Father. We ask you, you know we need another church building and everything. Father, we know you got it. And we believe in it. And when you're ready to give it to us, you give it to us, Father. But let us see you through all things. We ask you these things and all things. In your son's name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.